of, let's look at social media. 57% of all people in China are active on one or more social media platforms. You might say, hey, hold on, only 53% of them were online. How can that be? Well, one of the reasons is this is a different statistical company and they sometimes have slight differences. But I think there's also a probability of duplication because some people have multiple accounts on the same platform. And even though the Chinese government is trying to get people to register with their real name, there's still a lot of different accounts and also zombie accounts going around in China. You might also say, well, hold on, social media in China. China wasn't that country where the government blocks Facebook and Twitter and YouTube? I didn't even know that they had social media. But they do. Basically, what happened is the government blocks our Western social media platforms because they cannot control the content published on those websites. And they can do that with Chinese internet companies. They can go to a Sina Weibo or they can go to Tencent and say, we want you to remove that information, otherwise we'll revoke your license to be an internet company. What this created, this situation where you didn't have any of the Western platforms, is that it created sort of like a walled garden where the Western companies could not compete, but it also created a situation where a lot of Chinese internet companies started copying the Western platforms. So all of a sudden you had 10 copies of Facebook and you had 5 copies of Twitter. When Groupon started in the United States, there were 3,000 Groupon clones in China. And what normally happens is that there's consolidation and some of these companies remain. But the remarkable thing is that what you'll see here is that where we normally have just one Facebook, just one Twitter, just one YouTube, China has multiple platforms doing the same thing. And I can also tell you that these platforms are most of the time superior to what we have in the West. And the reason is because of the competition between these platforms. Facebook doesn't really have to innovate very much. They get a lot of advertising income from all of the advertisers that put their adverts on Facebook. But there's not a lot of competition. Google Plus tried to break into that market, never really succeeded. So they basically have a monopoly. Well, in China, you had different companies competing for the same space. And one of the ways they won the competition is by innovating, to make better platforms. And that's why most of the Chinese social media platforms, as you'll especially see with Thijs's presentation later on, are really very far ahead. China is more than 5 years ahead, I think, of where we are at the moment. I'm not going to run through all of these. You're going to get them in the handouts. But be rest assured that for every idea we have come up with in the West, China has copied it and made it better. So, three important names to remember. Baidu, sometimes called the Chinese Google. Search engine, very strong in search engine marketing. Alibaba, strong in e-commerce. And Tencent, that's the company behind WeChat. Those are the three biggest internet companies in China, but they also go into different areas because Alibaba, basically an e-commerce company, has shares in Weibo and is owner of Youku. Weibo is China's biggest microblogging platform, and Youku is one of the YouTube-like platforms. Now, you can see that WeChat, and Thijs will talk more about that later, but 35% of all of the time that Chinese people spend online is being spent in the WeChat app. And you'll find out later why. These are the big platforms. Qzone is always shown as a very big platform with a lot of active users, but this is probably because it's linked to QQ. And QQ is an instant messenger, like Amazon, like instant chatting. And if you open a QQ account, then you automatically get a Qzone page, which is more like a Facebook page. But I don't think that a lot of people are actively using their Qzone page. The important ones are WeChat and Sina Weibo. Renren used to be a Facebook clone, but has gone really downhill and is dead and decomposing at the moment. Douban is a really nice platform. Douban is a platform where people discuss about movies, about music, about literature, all kinds of different things. And Momo used to start as the Chinese Tinder and has grown into a platform that's more of a community-based on top of dating at the moment.
The use of proxies is popular in China.
The use of VPNs, you mean? Or yeah, yes and no. If Chinese people want to go on Facebook or if they want to go on any of the Western platforms, they need to have a virtual private network. They need to install that on the computer and then they can sort of jump the firewall and access some of those platforms. But only 4% of the Chinese people are using that. And it's mostly the people that have international friends. And they might want to check out Facebook. And then when they see Facebook or when they see WhatsApp, WhatsApp you can use in China, by the way, they'll think, this is prehistoric. And they'll very few people use it on a very frequent basis. So, yeah. Microblogs, in China called Weibo, so basically the Twitters, have always been really popular in China. And as you can see here, in 2012, almost 90% of the people was using a microblog of the online people. Now, just imagine that 90% of the people would be using Twitter. I don't think that's the case for all of the online people. I think Twitter, don't know how many people are using it, but definitely not 90% of the online netizens. And in China, it's always been very popular, and the reason is the Chinese language. Now, some people here in the room probably speak and write Chinese, but for the people that don't, a Chinese character is basically a word. It's not a letter like we have in the alphabet. So every character you see here, for instance, Ren means person, and Feiji means airplane, all of these things are words, not specific letters. So that means that this person has written a text, 94 characters, and still has 46 characters left. If you translate this into English, it's this text, and we would need to stop here. Whereas this Chinese person still has 50% to continue. So the Weibos, the microblogs in China, have always been much more like our Facebook, because you could tell your little stories much better with Chinese characters. And that's one of the reasons why it was always very popular. Currently, Sina Weibo has 340 million active users. And most of them, again, are using it on their mobile phone. Thijs is going to talk a lot about WeChat, but I want to quickly mention it. I'm also going to send you in the email you're going to get at 7 o'clock a presentation which goes much more into depth about the user functions of WeChat. But suffice it to say that if this is a Western phone and we have different apps for all kinds of different functionalities, we have something for our social networking, we have PayPal and internet banking, we have our Instagrams, we have our group buying, we have our e-commerce. But all of these things that you see on this mobile screen can be done in WeChat in China. So that doesn't mean that the Chinese people are only using one app, but they are very used to things being integrated in WeChat and having a lot of functionality. That's why WeChat currently has 938 million users. Now, again, you might think, hold on, there's only 700 something million people being online. So who are the other guys? The estimation is that about 100 of them are outside China. And most of the people outside China that are using WeChat are Chinese people or people that have a lot of contact with Chinese people. There's also some duplication because some people have found a way to have multiple WeChat accounts on their telephones or even use multiple telephones. So there's some duplication in here, but you can rest assured that anybody with a mobile phone, more than 90% of those people will be using WeChat in China. It's also possible from an e-commerce perspective to buy things in WeChat, but this is something that's also exploded in the recent years, has doubled the number of people that are buying stuff through WeChat. And this is a real threat to Alibaba that sees some of their business shifting to social selling, to social platforms. To wrap up, to sum up the different apps you have in China, there's a lot of apps with a low penetration and a low stickiness. Stickiness is the time you spend within that app. So there's all kinds of different platforms. Again, some of them might be very interesting to reach your consumer, but from a niche perspective. There's on the other end of the scale, there's a couple of apps only. That's QQ, the instant messenger. There's WeChat and there's Weibo that have a very high stickiness and a very high penetration. So lots of people are using them and spending lots of time in them. Here in the middle, this is Momo. This is Qzone and this is Cheba, I think. And this is Baidu Cheba. Used more often, but not as big as these platforms over here. So a totally different market than here in the West. And the main platforms are used for different things. So WeChat is mostly used to interact with your existing friends, whereas Momo, dating app, is used to make new friends. And you have Weibo, which is mostly used to find interesting news and gossip and hot topics that are going on online. So they have different user perspectives. To sort of summarize this, and I'm not going to spend a long time discussing all of the bullets, but Weibo, because of the reach and because it's an open platform, it can be very, very successfully used for creating awareness. Things go viral much easier on Weibo, whereas WeChat is mostly a platform where you can only interact with your friends and share things with your friends and not with people outside your circle. But it is, from a business perspective, a very good platform to use for CRM and mobile commerce. Mobile commerce is another area of the market, so anything that's being sold through smartphones that has exploded, especially since 2014-2015. This is the fastest growing e-commerce segment. And China is, with the exception of South Korea and the United Emirates, is the country with the highest penetration of mobile commerce. Also, what you see, and that's not too surprising if you have seen the 80% from Alibaba I showed you before, is that the market is shifting from desktop computers to mobile. So more and more people are buying mobile, and the market is roughly comparable. Again, in this case, C2C and B2B, Alibaba owns 80% of the market, and the biggest competitor is JD.com. The reasons, on top of the reasons we already had for the strong growth in e-commerce, the reasons why m-commerce is so explosively growing in China are the following. There's under government pressure on the telecom companies, there's been a strong increase in coverage of high-speed internet, and also there's more Wi-Fi hotspots in some of the biggest cities. Also, you have more penetration of smartphones in the countryside and among lower income groups. And that always was a problem in the beginning, because the people, for instance, in the countryside, or people working as factory workers, the migrant workers on the East Coast, they didn't have a lot of money to buy an expensive iPhone. But they eventually got to have a smartphone, even though, like you see here, most of the people do not own a desktop or a laptop computer, but they could get their hands on an iPhone. And that has been driven specifically by a company called Xiaomi. And Xiaomi, what they did is they looked at the iPhone and they sort of copied it and made something which is comparable in functionality and maybe also quality for half the price. But what they also did is they said, well, this is our top model, but we want to make a phone that is affordable for everybody in China. And they made the Hongmi, for instance. And the Hongmi is 700 renminbi. It's about 100 euro. So anybody in the countryside or working in a factory on the East Coast could save up a bit of money to buy a Hongmi. And they therefore could go online. There's new payment models that have made it very easy to pay through your mobile phone, and I'll give you some examples later on. The two most important ones are WeChat and Alipay. And nowadays in China, there's several movies online that show you how you can do that. It's not really necessary to have any cash anymore. You can pay basically everything with your mobile phone, up to some very specific things that you would not expect. I'll show you in a minute. There's a very fierce competition between Alipay and WeChat. And around this time, they probably have the same amount of market share. Probably both of them have 40-45%. If you ask people what payment option have you used, then they will mention Alipay more often than cash. And this one, WeChat Pay, will have increased also in the last 2 years. And where have you used mobile payments? I've used mobile payments in the supermarket, to pay my phone bills, to order food, to order train tickets and airplane tickets. They use mobile payment for everything, basically, in China. QR codes, you'll see QR codes everywhere around China. And China is really the only country where QR codes have really become what they should be used for, to make the connection between offline and online. And that's why 50% of the Chinese internet users are scanning QR codes. Whereas we in the West, if we see a QR code, we go like, ugh, what's that? Don't put that in your advertising, that's ugly. So they've even figured out a way to make QR codes really pretty. So, like I said, use of QR codes and mobile payment. This is in October. I was back in Xi'an. And in the morning, I like to go out and buy a jianbing. Jianbing is like a pancake. And the street seller puts all kinds of like spicy stuff and sauces in it. And in the past, I used to pay her with cash, like 3 RMB. Now I can just scan the QR code on a mobile phone. And there goes 3 RMB from my mobile wallet into her mobile wallet. The same thing, this is a picture somebody took of a sweet potato seller. In the winter, they sell roasted sweet potatoes in the street. And he just printed out his QR code, which you can scan to pay him. And here on the right, this is a beggar who's singing songs in the street to try to make a living. And you can choose if you want to pay by WeChat or by Alipay. This is how far QR codes and mobile payments have already been integrated in the Chinese society. And it's coming this way as well. Alipay and WeChat are both making moves, and Thijs will show you more about it later on, to enable, specifically for Chinese tourists that are coming here, to make it easy for them to pay with Alipay.